Can you hear me all the way in the back? Yes?
Yes.
Okay. Well, you don't need the, I don't need an introduction because they already introduced me. Anyway, let me tell you who I am. Aside from being an old geezer here of 95, but I will try my best for you to hear me all the way in the back, and I hope you'll get something out of my history that I am about to tell you. I am a retired physician who practiced in this area, Chicago area, on the south side, for almost 50 years. And I taught at the medical school here. And trying to avoid what you had to experience a few days ago in April, snow and cold and freezing, I retired at the age of 75. As I said, told Les, you quit while you're ahead. And I've been there ever since. Now, I'm not here to teach medicine. That's past history. I am here as a Holocaust survivor. Now, I think that some of you may not know what Holocaust was. As a matter of fact, if you read the newspapers, about two-thirds of young people in the U.S. never heard of the Holocaust, never heard of Auschwitz, and some never even heard of World War II. Forgot completely about World War I. But I'm not here to teach history. But I have to mention something about history because that's what this is connected with. Now, my name is Alexander B. White. Now you will wonder, where did I take the name White? My name was White Hare in Polish, Białowłos. The B, my middle initial, now stands for my old name. And I went to the barber, cut off the hair, and I got old and white anyway, so I'm white without the hair. Now, where do I come from? I come from Poland. You see it there? This is the new Poland. When I lived there up to 1939, it looked different. Les, can you show the other map? And that's not unusual because in Europe, borders kept changing continually. There were continually wars going on, and borders kept changing. And I, on this map, come from, here's Krakow, can you see it? And my town, Krosno, was just about 90 miles to the southeast. There used to be the Soviet Union, here used to be Germany. Now, I had a family, we were a family of six, two parents who, when they perished, they were only 42 years old. My mom, my dad was only 52 years old. And I had a sister who was 17 years in 1939. I was 16, a little younger than you. I had a brother who was 14, and the youngest who was 8 years old. Of all us six, I am the only survivor. That will tell you what the Holocaust was. The word Holocaust was coined by one of the survivors. Hol means total, cost means destruction, total destruction of a people. Genocide, but total destruction. And in its sense, in its strict sense, Holocaust only applies to people of Jewish origin. But in its loose interpretation, it applies to very many people. It applies to all Slavs, Slavic people, Poles, Czechs, Yugoslavians, Russians, and so on, Gypsies, and all kinds of people that Adolf Hitler, the Nazi leader of Germany, felt don't have a right to live. So I'm here to tell you 5 years under Nazi occupation, what it was like. Now, I said Jewish people. I once spoke to a bunch of veterans in Arizona, and one lady came over to a friend of mine, a retired American colonel, and she asked, I'd like to see how a Jew looks like. Well, so he brought her over to me, and now she could see what a Jewish person looks like. I told her that the horns I left at home. So, but anyway, so some people may not know who is Jewish. Jewish is a religion, and Christianity, as well as Islam, derive from that religion, and the Old Testament, and all the prophets, and so on and so on. So Jews preserved their belief all the way, and I'm told that I am a descendant of King of David, and of the high priest in Jerusalem. Now, whether that is true, I don't know. But that's what I am told. Anyway, Poland looked in 1939 the way you see it, all the way. But Adolf Hitler, who rose to power in Germany January 30th, 1933, was a hater, and he hated Jewish people. Very much so that eventually he decided to kill them all. But not initially. Initially in the 30s when he took over, he was killing his own handicapped German children, handicapped adults that were mentally ill and had no chance of becoming breadwinners, but as his killer, Heinrich Himmler, the head of the SS, said, they were bread eaters and not breadwinners. Therefore, they decided they don't have a right to live. Many people don't know that. In the 30s, before he even killed Jewish people, he killed his own, close to 200,000 handicapped German children and mentally ill were sent to gas chambers. There was no such a thing as gas chambers before for human beings. That was the Nazis' invention. And that was in the 30s. So I'm going to take you back to September 1st, 1939. Although I lots of times start with the history all the way from World War I, but that would take too long. You would have to be here all night. So I will just start from World War II, which was September 1st, 1939. I have to tell you first something. Why should you know about it? Why am I here for you to know about it? Let me explain it to you with a caricature that I saw years ago by Ed Wiley, a famous caricaturist here in the United States. He showed an old man sitting on a bench. It was a hot day, without his jacket and a short sleeve shirt. And a young boy was sitting on the same bench. So he went over to him and he looked at his forearm, at this old man's forearm, and he sees some horrible tattoo, but not the tattoo he is used to see. It's pictures of girls and this and that. And he said, "Sir, can I ask you a question? What is this awful tattoo in your forearm?" So he said, "Well, come over here and I will tell you." So he pulled his sleeve up and he showed it him, and he says, "You see, this was done to me when I was your age by evil people who murdered my family, and I was next in line, but by God's grace, I was saved and I am here." So the youngster tells this man, "Now I can see why you like to preserve this, to remind you that there are evil people in this world and we have to watch out and be careful." He said, "No, not to remind me, to remind you, the young people, that there's lots of evil in this world still now, even after the Holocaust. And if you will forget it, it's likely to happen again." And that's why it's important for the young generation and for generations to come to know about it or it will never happen again. Now, some of you may say, "Well, we live in America. That is we have a constitution, we have a Bill of Rights. That could never happen here." Well, if it happened in Germany, it can happen here. Because Germans were not killers. Germans were nice, hard-working people, highly educated in Europe. As a matter of fact, Germany had about 400,000 Germans of Jewish descent among 65 million of Christians prior to World War II. And they were integrated into society that you couldn't tell the difference. Most Germans didn't know Jews from beans. But Hitler came along, who hated them and blamed all the ills in Germany, the loss of World War I, the depression, and so on. Everything is the Jews did that. And he started this whole thing that eventuated in killing of 6 million Jewish people. But not only 6 million Jewish people died, about close to 2.5 million Polish Christian died. Gypsies died. Homosexuals died. Transvestites died because he did not like them. And of course, anyone that opposed them in any way died as well. The total number of deaths in World War II came to, what I read in the books, to 60-some million, 60 million people, related not only to his racial policies, but also to his expansion policies. He wanted to expand the German Reich, especially eastward, have the Slavic people, Russians, Poles, Czechs, Yugoslavians, Croatians, Slovenians, be the wood choppers and the water carriers for the glorious German race. And these people don't need to be in any way educated other than to know the German language, so they will understand the orders. If they have to dig a ditch, that they will dig the ditch properly. And Hans Frank, the governor, the Nazi governor of Poland, said, I don't care even if 5,000 Poles die, as long as that ditch is completed. So that was their policy, and that's why you should know about it, because it could happen here. Germany had a constitution during the interwar period between World War I and World War II that was essentially the same as the American constitution. But to Hitler, it was meaningless. Just tore it up, threw it in the garbage, and that was the end. Because a constitution is just a piece of paper or parchment on which it is written. But it needs the people to guard those provisions. And if the people don't guard those provisions, you know, he is playing the Almighty, or playing Jesus Christ. He decides who is to live and who is not, and so on. So it is extremely important that you should know it, and for it never to happen in this country. The Germans were not ready to defend those provisions. They didn't march like they march here for the unborn. They didn't march even for the born. In the 30s, when he was killing his own, nobody stood up, no one marched on the street. The first time this came to light was when the Bishop of Münster in Germany stood at the pulpit and condemned the killing of the handicapped children and so on. And I read that Heinrich Himmler, the SS chief, was asked by the head of the SS in Münster, what should we do with this bishop? He said, he is too famous, we cannot do very much now, but when we win the war, we will take care of him. Well, fortunately, they didn't win the war. So anyway, I'm bringing you back to September 1st, 1939, when I'm awakened early in the morning, and I hear bombing in my hometown, a small town of 18,000 population, or from Jewish Poles, comprised about 2,400, 2,600. I hear the bombing, and from school I was to be a warden. That meant to chase the people into the cellars. But when I got out on the street, people were standing there just watching the German Stukas, that's what they were called, Sturzkampf, in short, Stukas, were descending on the air base in our town, descending on the train station and bombed it. And no one bothered going into the cellar. They were very precise. They knew exactly what to bomb. Only one house was damaged, and I know it because my family was in the glass business. So we were glazing windows, and we had to go and glaze the windows of that gentleman, Mr. Markevich, of his house that was near the airbase. They were very precise. They also bombed in a village near us the electricity plants. So there was no electricity, and so on. And to make a long story short, they marched to Poland very rapidly. Now, what we did not know was that Hitler, before he decided to attack Poland, had made a deal with Stalin, two arch enemies of one another. One the extreme left, Stalin, the other one the extreme right. But when it comes to gain something, they go to bed together. So what happened is they made a deal that as soon as the Germans defeat the Polish army, and the Polish army wasn't prepared for war. No one was prepared for war 20 years after World War I. The Polish cavalry didn't have a tank even. They were near us in a city called Sanów. They were on horses with swords all the way down to their ankles. It was ridiculous. And he has a highly mechanized army that Hitler built up during the 30s with modern tanks that America didn't have. As a matter of fact, I read in the paper an American general who was in Germany in the 30s, and he watched their military parades, was amazed that American tanks were still from World War I, were one guy sat on top, he had his both feet sitting on the guy who was directing the tank, and if he wanted him to go right, he kicked him on the right shoulder. If he wanted to go left, he kicked him on the left shoulder. It was ridiculous. And I saw he testified at Senate hearing. He said, we are backward. They had everything, and they weren't supposed to do any of it, because in the Versailles Treaty, when Germany lost World War I, they weren't supposed to have an army. They weren't supposed to build this and that, but they did, and everyone ignored it. And when Hitler decided to march into the Rhineland, well, the Allies, which is the British and the French, essentially, weren't very happy with it, but no one wanted to go to war over it. So he decided to go more. He annexed Austria to Germany, named it the Ostmark. Then, still nothing. So he decided he wants the western part of Czechoslovakia, Sudetenland, it's called Sudeti, and south. And the British and the French sent their prime ministers and appeased them and forced the Czechs, who were ready to fight, to relinquish and to avoid war. And Hitler said, that's it. I don't want any more, he promised them. So, but then he started threatening Poland. And the British and the French, which we refer to as the Allies, promised Poland and made a friendship agreement that should Hitler attack Poland from the west, from here, they are going to attack Germany from the west. So that will force Hitler to fight a two-front war. And old military men in Germany, von Clausewitz and all kinds of military historians, war and Bismarck warned that Germany cannot win a two-front war and they must avoid it. But he knew that the guys weren't prepared, and he was confident he's going to win. So massive armies marched into Poland. We tried to escape, and many people tried to escape eastward. We hoped that We hope that the Vistula River, which traverses Poland this way, up to the Baltic Sea, they're going to be stopped because the British and the French are going to start shooting in the West. But they didn't. We tried to escape. My uncle, who was in business with us, we were in the glass glazing and beveling and so on, managed with his family to get to the last train out of my hometown, down below, as I told you, southeast of Krakow here. And they were going west, rather east. And when we decided to go to the train station, the train station was bombed and no more trains. So we hired a peasant with a horse and a wagon to take us east, northeast. So we were going from there, a little bit up there. We didn't get very far because Polish roads weren't highways. There were dirt roads with potholes all over the place. And here are thousands of refugees, everyone streaming to the east. Of course, nobody knew that Hitler and Stalin had an agreement that as soon as Hitler defeats the Polish army, the Soviets from the east are going to march into this part of Poland. Because many people wouldn't escape eastward because they would have known that if they go to the east, they're going to be under Stalin. And it would make to them a big difference to be under Hitler or Stalin. To Jews, it made a difference, but not to non-Jewish people. So the roads were clogged with refugees, and we didn't get very far. We stopped in a small little town just northeast of our town, called Dinov. When I woke up the following day there, we were allowed to stay in a Mr. Iglesias house, a guy who fixes glass windows. He bought glass from us. So he let us stay in his kitchen. We were lying on the floor, sleeping on the floor. We didn't have any pillows, so we just used the jacket as a pillow. And there were loads of refugees. There was no space even to walk. So we were there. Just a day or 2 days later, I woke up in the morning, and I went to the central square, and I see a German military unit in the square fixing their lunch. They had a field kitchen there, and they were very nice. So people were standing there and watching them, and they were handing out candy and cigarettes. Extremely nice. Very much what we knew Germans to be before Hitler came to power. So my dad decided we will go back home.